On today's episode of the 2020 Awards podcast, we've asked our guest editor, Tracy the H's Silent Dethlefs, to share with us what he believes is an example of great editing. Tracy asked us to take another look at Billy Wilder's movie, The Apartment.
Where you're going, you should. Would you mind leaving your body to the university?
It's not me. I mean, it's just once in a while I have a few people in for a drink.
As a matter of fact, you must be an Iron Man all around. From what I hear through the walls, you got something going for you every night.
I'm sorry if it gets noisy.
Sometimes there's a twi-night doubleheader. A nebbish like you.
Yeah, well, I'll see you, Doc.
You know, Baxter, I'm doing some research at the Columbia Medical Center. I wonder if you could do us a favor.
Me?
When you make out your will and the way you're going, you should. Would you mind leaving your body to the university?
For 20-plus years, Tracy has worked in almost every aspect of production and post-production up and down the West Coast. Tracy has been involved in creating commercials, films, and television series for MTV, PBS, Comedy Central, and the BBC. He's worked with a range of talented folks and was once told by Britney Spears that his fly was down. Welcome back to the show, Tracy.
My fly is up, just for the record.
Fly is optional here, so.
Is it?
We're all sitting down.
Then I'm going without pants.
There's kids listening to this.
Which, by the way, as I was telling you, I watched The Apartment last night with my 2.5-year-old, and sadly, he is not as big a fan of it as I was.
All right, we'll recap the movie and then get everybody out there up to speed if you haven't seen it. So basically, The Apartment.
And what's wrong with you if you haven't seen it? That's all I have to say.
All right, that's fair enough. Jack Lemmon plays an up-and-comer at an insurance company who's trying to rise up the chain through the corporate ladder. And the way he does this is he lets executives use his apartment for trysts of course, complications and a romance of his own arises. Everyone around Lemmon sees him as a schmuck, and the film is really about how he eventually stands up for himself and becomes a mensch, to quote his neighbor. The film was edited by Daniel Mandell. So, Tracy, I asked you to give us an example of what you think is a great editing. You chose The Apartment. Kind of a surprising choice for a lot of reasons.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great film. It's well edited. Why did you choose it as an example of great editing?
Well, it's sort of a subterfuge here because I'm talking about this film because I really want to talk about Billy Wilder. But it was also because this film, I've never heard of this before, and before or since. This film was put together in a week.
And
it was edited in a week. It won best editing. And when they were done, there was 1,000 feet of film left. 1,000 feet of film is about 11 minutes. So this, to me, is, I think, not only Billy Wilder's most Billy Wilder film, which is to me a film that perfectly balances the sweet and the sour,
mm-hmm.
but it also is such a brilliant film because Billy Wilder was at the height of his powers and he knew what he wanted to shoot. He just shot what he needed.
Yeah.
And, you know, like that there's a great Christmas party and he actually shot that on December 23rd. And it was, it was basically, it goes like everybody was in the right mood. It was one take.
So it was kind of The Office Christmas party anyway.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, I watched little documentary that came with the DVD I have.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess Shirley MacLaine was saying that he didn't do any like big wide shots for the actors.
Because
he knew exactly what he wanted. So a lot of times they didn't really know how the scene was shaken out. Like in the scene where Jack Lemmon gets punched, her reaction is just Billy Wilder snapping a twig or something.
Exactly.
Or making a loud sound.
Yeah. There was a great story about how Audrey Wilder, who came to the set one time, asked, you know, was pulled aside by Shirley MacLaine and says, "Does Billy like this film? Does he know where it's going?" Like he had only given her about 40 pages of the script, and to sort of keep her on the edge about how it ends, and so she was just sort of playing it truthfully, but not quite sure where it was going.
Yeah.
And so she really had, you know, some questions about, you know, how it ended. And the end is so perfect, but a lot of that was scripted on the fly, including the very last line, which Wilder has just Like he has the best lines, I think, of any director.
Every ender.
Yeah, I mean, right. Just like and he has a theory that basically, you know, when you are in the third act, you know, you've got to build up tempo, you've got to build up action until you get to that final event, and then get out.
Yeah,
you know, don't linger.
Right,
and he does that. It's just like, you know, land that thing, and then, you know, out the door.
Thanks. Good night.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah. So it, I think. It's just Mandell had done one film with him before, but then he did like the next five films with Wilder, and so next four films with Wilder, and so did six films with them, and they were really good collaborators, and just I just boggles my mind that the best picture winner, I mean, that a film of this caliber could be edited in a week. And that just shows me that it's, you know, this was a director who was just
on knew what top he wanted. Of his
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I went to school at Cal Arts, and one of our teachers there was Sandy McKendrick, also known as Alexandre McKendrick. And he's the guy that did Man in the White Suit and a bunch of those old Ealing comedies. But his first American film was The Sweet Smell of Success, which I know you love.
Yeah. Lee. Mm-hmm. We watched it together a year ago.
And he told stories about how, like, he was so terrified that the studio was going to take it away from him in the editing room that he just made the craziest camera moves where the action would cross the line, you know, so that you'd cross the axis between the actors so that the film could only be cut together one
certain
way.
Yeah.
And it was his sort of, you know, fail-safe system to make sure that, like, nope, this is how this movie's going to be cut.
This is how the story is going to be.
Yeah.
There's no way to change it.
Don't mess with it. And it sounds kind of very similar. Like, it's...
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's... Again, I think back in that day, I think those guys, they really, really knew what they were doing.
Yeah. Yeah. Know? Well, I mean, if you go to IMDB and you look at Billy Wilder, you know, prepare to spend a couple hours, because he just, you know, like, it's like, what are you going to look at on as him as a writer, him as a director, as a producer? Like, he just... Yeah. He had so much... work up to that point, and he learned from so many great ones like Lubitsch and all this stuff. But you know, there was an interesting case that could be made by Wilder himself that this was the height of his career, and when he was accepting at the Oscars that night, his third Oscar, he'd won for Best Screenplay, Best Director, and Best Film, and when he was accepting the award for Best Director, for Best Film, Moss Hart, who was the presenter, leaned in and said, "It's time to quit, Billy," and that haunted him. That haunted him, you know, because he was kind of like going, "Yeah, how am I going to top The Apartment?"
Yeah,
you know, and that was a hard question for
me. What came after this? You know,
I think it was.
Well, I mean, like, not immediately, but what followed? This?
Irma Deuce.
Yeah, and Fortune Cookie. Trying to remember
The front page.
I mean, he still had some good ones.
Yeah,
you know, but it just, this was definitely, I think, his high watermark.
Yeah. With all due respect,
mm-hmm.
you know, I think, you know, in an earlier podcast, I did introduce you as one of Seattle's most highly sought after editors, and I know that for a fact. Everybody loves working with you, and I think. I was expecting maybe something that had a little flashier editing style, because I think a lot of editing is sort of seen that way. Mm-hmm. It's like, and so it's like, but I also think that this is sort of an example of, like, this is something where the filmmakers trusted the material and they trusted the performers.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, you don't have to have a lot of editing. Yeah. Well, that's a stupid thing to say, have to have a lot of editing. But I mean, it's something where it's like, you can let the movie breathe and you can let the audience just sit there and sink in, or, you know, let it wash over the audience and you kind of get swept up in it. Do you think that maybe more modern filmmakers rely on editing to save them?
I think that's a great point, because I think that we're at a point right now where there is, there's such a democratization of the tools. There is, you know, when I started editing, I had to really, you know, love a project or get somebody to pay for my editing time, because it was, you know, $300 an hour at Bay Area Video Coalition to get on the Avid. And, you know, the tools weren't available the way that now I can download something onto my phone and edit, you know, footage I shoot on my phone right there, you know, and so for 99 cents, you know. And so there's a, I can't remember which French New Wave director said it, but somebody said, when the tools of filmmaking get as inexpensive as pen and paper, then that's when the real artists will emerge. Mm-hmm. And we're kind of getting to that point. But the thing that is also happening now is that, you know, everybody's making a film. And
right.
there's so many choices. There's so many different ways you can cut something. And I think that why I think this film is such a great example of good editing is that it will hold up. It holds up now. I think it still holds up as a great film now.
Yeah.
I think that in 10 years, it'll still hold up as a great film. I think in 50 years, it'll still be a great film. Whereas, like, if you say something where, you know, you're really drawn to the editing, the editor is saying, look at me, like a Oliver Stone film or something, mm-hmm. you know, or a Quentin Tarantino film to a certain degree, like where they're really being flashy and they're doing a lot of things, they will in time become sort of dated and be just like, well, that was that period. That's what they were doing. They were doing the rock focus of that time,
right.
or they're doing the swish pan or whatever. And what I like about this is that this is just so sturdy. You know, this is good. Danish furniture, that mid-century furniture that just keeps, you know,
keeps
looking
back.
Good no matter where you put it, whatever part of the house. So I think there's something to be said for editing that isn't flashy, because that also is, it, you know, when you make flashy editing, that can be ego, you know. And I think that the editor in the proper context should be, you know, calling attention to the editing when it's appropriate. My job is to make you look good, to make the actor look good or the film look good or whatever, and not necessarily call attention to myself.
Yeah.
So I think this film does that. It doesn't matter who Daniel Mandell is.
Right. Know? Yeah. I mean, it's not like somebody is like, oh, yes.
Yeah. Oh, he's yeah. The well, guy he we did. All...
Mandell
yeah,
touch.
Yeah, exactly.
He invented this technique. You
right.
know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So. I think I'm going to give it all up.
Give what up?
Why do people have to love people anyway?
I know what you mean.
The thing that I love about this film, and I've called it Wilder-esque, you know, being the perfect mix of sweet and sour, like, it was a sort of a risky film to take because we were just kind of coming out of the censorship, you know, mm-hmm. time. And, you know, to do a film that covers adultery and suicide attempt, and actually there's two suicide attempts. You know, there's two. There's a mention of another suicide attempt.
Right.
You know, and to kind of get in those things in something that's a mainstream comedy, like, is really bold.
Well, you know, it's funny that you say a mainstream comedy because the first time I saw this movie, I went to rent it and I pulled it out of the comedy section at the video store and just went home and watched it, and I just sat there and I was like, this isn't funny.
Yeah.
And I actually didn't enjoy the movie, and I had known from having spoken with other friends of mine who'd seen it, who loved it, I was like, okay, I clearly had put myself into the mindset that I should be laughing while I'm watching
from
this.
The director of Some Like It Hot.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. It's like, wait, this has got suicide?
Yeah,
and people are just like, these are not happy people.
Yeah.
And so, like, I actually had to go back and watch it a couple months later.
Yeah.
Like, clear the palette and go, okay, mm-hmm. what are we getting into here? And then, you know, loved it.
Yeah. But yeah, it was very, very Kafka-esque, that shot of all the desks and everything. And great, you know, great little backstory about that. Like how it was all done with, he just kept getting smaller and smaller desks and smaller extras. And then to the point where the desks at the very back are just cut out people and just tiny, tiny little desks.
Right.
Like I say, they were saying they had midgets or kids in the back way back.
Yeah.
And then super tall guys in the front.
Well, that reminded me of the other shot that
beautiful shot.
Stood out to me is the first night. Is it the first night? It's the night he spends on the park bench.
Mm, yeah.
And there's such a gorgeous composition where that... I don't know if that park bench is real or not, because they were
outside.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that park bench goes for, it feels 300 feet.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's just Jack Lemmon sitting there by himself on that park bench alone, and it's such a portrait of loneliness.
Yeah,
it's like, because you just look at that park bench and go like, well, that should be filled with people.
Yeah,
that should be like a party park bench.
Yeah,
but it's just him sitting there, and it just stretches to infinity.
Another fun thing is that he that Wilder doused him with antifreeze so that he would not freeze to death out there.
Does that work?
Apparently it does.
He lived quite a while after that. Yeah.
That would explain his very ruddish complexion, though. Speaking of ruddish complexions...
Let's try again.
Speaking of antifreeze, our sponsors today are Honest Tea and Hilliard's Beer.
they drank a lot in this film. Do you think they were drinking Hilliard's
beer? Speaking of a park bench that seems like a party, where... you could maybe watch a movie.
There's
from.
Something there.
Speaking
something
of
there.
Loneliness.
No. Get yourself a 6-pack of Hilliard's beer.
Our sponsors today are Honest Tea and Hilliard's Beer. Honest Tea, nature made it right. We put it in a bottle. Refreshingly honest. Honest Tea. Visit honesttea.com to find a distributor near you. And Hilliard's Beer, brewed and canned in Seattle's Ballard neighborhood, but drunk everywhere. Visit their tap room Thursday through Sunday and get more info on them at hilliardsbeer.com.
I love you, Miss Kubelik.
Three. Queen.
Did you hear what I said, Miss Kubelik? I absolutely adore you.
Shut up and deal.
Is this the type of film you wish you had cut?
A film that basically stands the test of time? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think...
not really.
Why would you... what a hack, that Mandell.
Yeah. So how do you judge whether or not something is well edited? You know, to me, it's like music. If your attention is being drawn to it,
mm-hmm.
it seems like it's not working.
Yeah.
Yet at the same time, how can you appreciate something then if it's not drawing attention to you or to it?
Well, let me answer that by thinking about how I knew that. So I was a drama major, and in college, I remember that there was a play that I saw my freshman year that made me want to become a drama major, and it was the play Orphans, which is a 3-man play that's a really powerful play that. At the end of it, I was so engrossed that when the lights, you know, went black and then they came out to do the curtain call, like I was almost outraged at a moment. Like I just was like going, oh, wait, you know, like I forgot that I was in, that I was watching a play. And I think that the films that carry you away and, you know, have that same kind of feeling are the films that are the best edited films, you know, that don't call attention to, you know, A, don't call attention to the editing, or, you know, don't call attention to things that you go like, oh, that's a, you know, I don't like the way that shot was composed, or, you know, anytime I'm looking at my watch, you know, I know that I'm not really into this
right.
film, you know. And The Apartment definitely, you know, it's, those kind of films, they're talky. There's not, you know, there's not car chases. There's not, you know, there's not a ton of action. There's not the MTV attention, you know, short attention span that we're used to now. It takes a bit to kind of watch some of these old talky films. But I still feel like when I watch The Apartment or when I watch any old Wilder film especially, I still get a lot out of it. I still can. It's like, you know, I haven't seen it yet, but people I respect keep telling me that was it Before Midnight? You know the Ethan Hawke
thing.
Yeah, that they say I love it, but there's it's all talk, and right. I'm going, wow, that's impressive.
You saw the first two ones, right?
Well, yeah, they're very much like that too. But it, you know, nowadays we're so used to fast cuts. We're so used to, you know, like, oh, people aren't gonna, you know, it's like when I'm doing corporate video editing or things like, everybody says like, well, it can't be longer than 3 minutes. You know, it's gotta be, it's gotta be so, because we're just so used to, you know, our attention kind of going over here, or I just got a ping on my phone and I gotta post on Facebook about how boring this movie is. Or
right.
You know, it's like, you know, it's like we're constantly on so many screens at once. And And I can still get sucked into a film like this. And that, for a film that was made over 50 years ago, that's telling me a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny, the corporate thing you mentioned, I think, again, talking during the break about the doc I'm doing, we were, at one point I was like, oh, you know what, I think I crammed too much stuff into the opening 3 minutes of the movie, because I'm so used to, you've got 3 minutes to tell the entire story, and it's like, oh, okay, you know what, we need to pull all of this back, we just gotta let it breathe, let it breathe, and, you know, it's funny, like, we went and watched a bunch of documentaries just to see their opening few minutes, and it was like, oh, they barely do anything. Yeah. It's just like, oh, just a little bit of information.
Yeah, set the hook and pull it later.
Yeah.
Well, and Wilder, you know, a great thing that, a great quote that he has is, if you have problems in your third act, it means you have a problem in your first act.
Right.
You know, and I think that's so true. Is like, you just, you know, and sometimes you can find that you will find that answer in your third act that need to be in the first,
you know,
or something like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's interesting. The thing in editing that I learned is that not everybody does this, but a lot of people do, where when they're answering a question, they will answer it briefly first. And then if they think that they've got, you know, they're not being interrupted or followed up, they will go into a little more detail, and then they will think they've been talking too long, and then they will wrap it up into a nice, tidy little bow.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're editing something and you're trying to find a bite or a coherent statement, you know, you might take a little bit from the very beginning, then there's a little section in the middle, and then you take that little end button and you make a little word salad, or as we say, Frankenstein a bite. You know,
which
I, you know, like I used to do all the time on MTV, where I would take with Britney Spears, you know, she would be saying, you know, and, you know, anyway, like, we're going to make this, it's going to be awesome video. And you cut it up with, you know, so it'd be like, and we're going to make this awesome video, and cut out the and ums and likes and all that stuff.
You made her seem, I thought she was way smarter.
What's that?
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, actually made her a little more coherent than she should be. So yeah, it's also the bane of the editor, is that where you go to the rap party and you will see somebody that you've spent hours with, you've spent days you know, cleaning them up and making them seem intelligent and do all this stuff, and you're going, hey, how you doing? And they have no idea who you are.
Right. Yeah.
Dude, I made you look good.
Yeah. That happened to me once. Yeah. Well, not that I was
just
at
once.
Yeah, no, that happened to me. I was at a party once. And I was like, how do I know these people? Like,
yeah,
I know these people. And it wasn't until I got in the car. I was driving home. I was like, oh, they're in that show that I cut.
Yeah.
It's like this very strange sensation. You're a big Wilder fan.
Mm-hmm.
I presume. Is he like your top guy? Or
he's definitely my top guy, because he did so many films that it seemed like, you know, it's like, yeah, I'm going to do film noir and I'm going to knock it out of the park. I'm going to make Double Indemnity, you know, I'm going to, which is part of the reason that I've always had a lifelong crush on Barbara Stanwyck. I just have this, yeah, it's crazy. But
I have a crush on Shirley MacLaine now after seeing The Apartment again.
I know, yeah.
I just fell in love with her.
But, you know, whatever he did, like whether it was political satire or whatever he did, he seemed to just, you know, just make a fantastic film.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Not all of them were aces, but he still, you know, unless it was Ace in the Hole, but you know, he still, thank you. Tip your waitresses.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, you look at that guy's track record versus a lot of people and it's like, he's got a higher batting average than most.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Good on base percentage.
Yeah. So the other movie that you were kind of waffling between The Apartment and the other film?
I was thinking of Lawrence of Arabia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think might have the world's most famous cut.
Which is?
Blowing out the match and cutting to the desert.
Ah, yeah. That's yeah, excellent. Yeah.
It,
you know, the thing I think is so fascinating about that, and since you opened the door to this, is that it was edited by Ann V. Coates, which actually this is sort of a sidebar, but you know, it's interesting that I think some of the best in film history, some of the best editors are women.
Yeah.
Because back in the day, they started out and they said, well, they're just stitching the film together.
Right.
They're just, you know, it's like sewing, you know, it's like, well, women do it. And so many of them started out or were put on that role because it was, you know, it's not heavy lifting and all this stuff. It was sort of a sexist classification, but it had such a profound effect on film history because I think that maybe women have an ability to see sort of keep multiple stories in their head a little bit clearer and be able to balance those a little bit better, and I think that's benefited filmmaking.
Oh, that's funny. You know, I never thought of that, but I mean, that idea, you know, because women are way better at multitasking than men are.
Yes.
And that totally makes sense. I never thought of it that way.
Yeah. It's just, well, and so Anne V. Coates, you know, did Lawrence of Arabia, and then she did another film that I loved, Out of Sight, which I know you don't love, but I think it's an interesting if you can make Jennifer Lopez seem like a good actress.
I thought Out of Sight was cool. I love that movie.
I love Out of Sight.
I'm not surprised.
Oh, come on. I think a lot of people like that movie.
They do. That surprises me.
But I mean, that has one of the best love scenes ever, where George Clooney and Jennifer Lopez are basically
in the trunk, right?
Well, there's that, but then there's also the hotel and the bar where they're flirting with each other while it's being intercut with them going into the room, and it's like so well cut, you know. And yeah. So anyway, I think it's amazing that somebody who could have edited Lawrence of Arabia could later on be working with a director like
the same woman.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Same
woman, yeah. Speaking of David Lean, that The Apartment was actually the idea for The Apartment came from Brief Encounter.
Oh, okay.
Because
really,
because Wilder was like going, well, what's it like to be the guy that has to crawl into the warm bed after two lovers have left it?
Right.
You know, and I thought that, you know, that's genius.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's always interesting to see is like, hey, what happens after that mayhem or, you know, whatever.
And then did they change the sheets?
What's that?
Did they change the sheets?
And
he had that single bed.
Remember they were complaining about, you know, that he wasn't had enough ice.
Crackers.
Or so I don't think they were, there was not a lot of you know, meeting him halfway in that situation.
We're about out of time. Anything else about The Apartment you want to?
Well, there's one little trivia thing, and then which is that the doctor's role, which was added late in the script. Originally going to go to Groucho Marx.
Was it really?
Yeah,
really?
And that that just really wouldn't have worked. They needed somebody who had some gravitas and who could basically sort of sit in judgment of him. And you felt sort of outraged, like going, no, he didn't make her. No, like you felt, you know. But it, so that was a great little casting, but also creating of that role.
That would not have worked.
Yeah, not at all. And
neither would Harpo Marx.
Had he been sitting in silent judgment? Came in with a horn, trying to, instead of slapping her.
Excellent choice, Tracy. And if you haven't watched The Apartment yet, do yourselves a favor. Get out there and watch The Apartment. Billy Wilder with Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine, and a bunch of, if you've watched any old TV show, you'll recognize. So thanks for joining us.
Absolute, my pleasure.
And hey, if anybody wants to follow your exploits, is there anywhere? Are you on Twitter?
I am on Twitter at Traced Editor, which is TRACEDITOR. And I'm on Facebook and all that stuff.
All right. If you're a movie lover and would like to support us, you can subscribe to the 2020 Film Club. Your annual subscription gets you into 10 of our monthly For Your Consideration screenings here in Seattle, plus a ticket to our annual ceremony in February. It's over $100 value for only $40. To enroll, just visit us at 2020.
That's only 10 lattes, people.
I know.
It's a really good deal.
Damn.
Yeah. To enroll, just visit us at 2020awards.org and look for the subscriber link. And until next time, remember, it's never too late to start thinking about the past.